Tomorrow, Pope Francis continues his American tour with a stop at a Catholic school in New York City. Since the 1960s, enrollment at Catholic schools in the United States has fallen by more than 50%. But the one Pope Francis will visit, and some others like it, have found ways to keep their doors open. The NewsHour's April Brown has our American graduate report.
She may only be in fourth grade, but Ngumbu Kamwa is becoming very media savvy. Over the past few weeks, she's been interviewed by dozens of news organizations at Our Lady Queen of Angels Catholic School in New York's East Harlem neighborhood to talk about the impending visit of the leader of the Catholic Church.
In nome del Padre, del Figlio, dello Spirito Santo.
Ngumbu will actually get to meet Pope Francis when he stops by the school, and she knows quite a bit about him.
His real name is actually Jorge Mario Bergoglio. I know that he's from Argentina and that he lives in Vatican City.
Seventh grader Jade Fuentes has also been studying the life of the pontiff.
He had loved animals, and he still does, because he relates to Saint Francis. That's where he had chosen his name.
Jade's mother, Nicole Fuentes, went to a Catholic school a few blocks away.
This is eighth grade graduation.
Fuentes says the area has changed a lot since then.
This neighborhood was diverse. You had Italian immigrants, Puerto Rican, African American, Polish.
Now it's largely African American and Hispanic, with fewer Catholics and many families that hit hard times during the recession.
Things just happened economically to this neighborhood, and we lost out on a lot of schools. And my school was one of them. The church still stands, but the school is no longer here.
St. Cecilia's is just one of about 6,500 Catholic schools that have closed in the U.S. over the past few decades. In the 1960s, there were nearly 13,000 across the country, educating more than 5 million students.
All right, Mount Sinai. Does anybody want to tell me what happened there? Because something very important happened.
Today, only about 2 million students attend Catholic school. And that's due to a variety of reasons, including falling birth rates among Catholics, the rise of charter schools in urban areas, and more Catholics moving to the suburbs. The cost of running these schools has skyrocketed too, leaving many struggling to stay open.
The parochial school system, as we've known it over the years, is a dinosaur. They can't possibly survive given the economics of the situation.
Charles Zeck is an economics professor at Villanova University who studies how churches manage their finances. Zeck says one major challenge in their workforce has hurt Catholic schools, which are historically known for both academic rigor and strict discipline.
Back in the day when the parochial schools were administered and most teachers were nuns, the labor costs were extremely low. You'd be hard-pressed to find any nun teaching in parochial schools today.
Lay teachers now fill most of those posts and get paid more than nuns who take a vow of poverty. Zeck says it can be very difficult to manage these institutions with fewer resources.
Historically, church leaders, the educators, they don't have financial backgrounds to be able to manage this kind of problem, do they?
Parochial schools are under the purview of the pastor of the parish. And for one thing, no priest I know became a pastor because he wanted to run a small business, which is what a parish and a school are. In addition, seminaries do just a terrible job of training their guys on management skills.
One Catholic school network that emerged in the mid-1990s has found an innovative way to deal with the financial challenges of parochial education. There are now 30 Cristo Rey schools across the country, including Don Bosco in Maryland.
For you alone are the Holy One, you alone are the Lord.
Catholic traditions, including Mass, are an important part of the day at Don Bosco, which found a home in a closed Catholic elementary school. One of the features that set these schools apart is that they not only offer a college preparatory education, but a work-study program as well. Each student is paired with an employer and works one day a week for all 4 years, helping to offset part of the $13,000 a year tuition.
How may I help you?
Senior Carlos Lopez has spent 3 years at the Washington, D.C. area power company Pepco. He says he's become more confident, invested in his own education, and now has skills that will be useful in any workplace.
I got to practice how to introduce myself, how to set a good first impression. I learned that those are really important out in the real world.
The president of Don Bosco Cristo Rey, Father Michael Conway, says the purpose of Catholic schools is much the same as it's always been.
here in this country, the Catholic education came about as a result of the huge immigration process that took place in the 1800s and the cry of the Catholic families to have their own schools. Many of them were struggling within the public school system to fit in. Many of them were ostracized.
Only now, he says, many Catholic schools are just serving different groups of young people.
That's why this is a unique school, because its mission is specifically for those who are at the poverty level or below.
And of the Holy Spirit, amen.
Our Lady Queen of Angels in Harlem has a similar mission, making sure a Catholic education is within reach for some of the city's most disadvantaged students. But it's found a different way to keep the doors open by turning to a strategy charter schools have used for years, hiring a management organization to run things. The Archdiocese of New York inked an agreement with the nonprofit Partnership for Inner City Education to oversee the educational and financial needs of Our Lady Queen of Angels and five other Catholic schools in Harlem and the Bronx. Kathleen Porter McGee is the superintendent of the six partnership schools.
Over the past several years, I think the conversation about urban Catholic education has been one of pessimism, of sadness that schools have been closing. But I think we're actually at a moment where the conversation is and should be about a renaissance and a real revitalization.
The partnership has been working to improve efficiency and share best practices among its six schools and stabilize revenue streams through a network of donors. The schools can't depend on tuition because more than two-thirds of the students need and receive scholarships.
One of the things that Pope Francis has really focused on is bringing the Catholic Church back to its mission of service to disadvantaged communities. And I know that that is something that has been part of what urban Catholic schools have done for generations and is certainly something that they do here at Our Lady Queen of Angels.
And many believe that's why the Pope has chosen to visit this school, which has taught children since 1892, many of them from immigrant families like Ngumbu's.
Make sure that it's seven, not two.
Her father, Jean-Pierre Kamwa, is originally from Cameroon.
Our neighborhood is a predominantly immigrant, low income, and even people who are out of work like myself. So if the Pope comes to our neighborhood, that means that he's going to try to reach the poor where they are.
Ngumbu, meanwhile, has been focusing on what she's expected to do when she meets the Pope.
When he comes in the room, we're going to sing the prayer of St. Francis to him, and we might, talk with him and pray with him.
And as many in this community hope Pope Francis's visit to the U.S. will bring Catholics back into the fold, there is also a belief that his stop at Our Lady Queen of Angels could spark a renewed interest in Catholic education as well. For the PBS NewsHour, I'm April Brown in New York City.